be able to keep busy for most part of the year. It has created jobs for people. It has also improved the production of food, and that also implies more income to the farmers. In the area of water supply, we have also embarked on rehabilitation of some of the dams, some of the water projects, especially the rural water scheme, boreholes, either motorized or which we have converted to solar. Some of them hand pump boreholes that have been dysfunctional for some time, we have had to rehabilitate them and train village level operation and maintenance mechanics. So much has been done in keeping with the roadmap that was developed in 2010.
Okay, we'll look at some of the specifics as we go on, but let's come to the water expert here. Take a look at the various projects that are in place to transform the sector. And what would be your comment on that? How would you assess them?
Well, it's true that Nigeria is blessed with abundant water supply, and efforts are being made to utilize the facilities very well, and we have in place policies and issues that are in place now that will move on improving these facilities, improving in delivery of this service to the people of Nigeria. And we have in the past learned a lot of lessons on this type of ad hoc activities that goes on. But now we are on issues of going into sustainable development. That sustainable development leads to coordination of activities between the ministry itself, the state governments, and even up to the local government with the beneficiaries, which are the communities at the community level. And this is growing up very well. It is happening very good in most of the areas in Nigeria. We know very well that as of today, we have almost about 3 million hectares of irrigatable land. And this is very huge, this is very big, but we are not using maybe up to 30% of that. But with the policies in place, as it is now, and with the efforts that is being put in by the Federal Ministry of Water Resources, we are beginning to see things coming out. We are beginning to see improvements are being made. We are beginning to see even the youth are taking up on their own efforts to see how they can support in the production of food to the entire populace of Nigeria. To us in the bank, we are supporting the policies, the processes, and of recent, we've just signed an agreement with the federal government of Nigeria for a loan of $450 million to help in the rehabilitation of what the minister has said, the Bakolori Dam, the Dadiunkowa Dam, the Chalawa Gorge in Kano, and also to develop and improve 446,000 hectares of land in all these areas, and to support also the improvement of the power supply through the hydro facility in Dadiunkowa, which is about 40 megawatts. And we are trying as best as our own best to see, to support and to help to see that this is put in place. And once this is put in place, in addition with what the minister has said, I'm very sure that in the next few years, we should be proud of saying that we are now at the level of producing food on 365 days for Nigerians.
All right, I'd like to take it off from the food aspect, and we have the farmer right here in our midst, and he should give us an insight into how this has helped to enhance food production as to guarantee self-sufficiency.
Water resources in Nigeria has been given the right attention under the transformation agenda of the President Goodluck Ebele Jonathan regime. We farmers of Nigeria, we are now looking at agriculture as business. We are no longer doing agriculture as community development. with the mention of that in Kowa power generation from the dam of 40 megawatts. That means the tomato company in that in Kowa and all the accessories going with it will come back to life, and it's already going on. So today, if you go to Kashimbila, Amambila Gorge, there is a water resources development that will be generating 3,500 megawatts of power. And the Kashimbila producing 40 megawatts of power. But that's not where farmers stopped. We started from there. With the assurance, the irrigational value drive that will be coming from these two dams will guarantee rice production in that valley to a level that if statistics are taken, Nigerians cannot believe that the northeast, where people look at as an insurgent infested area, is the one going to give the change that is going to come through the Ebele Goodluck Jonathan regime. And we are really happy from the northeast to assure the PTP government that we have no other government that will be taking care of us better than the PDP government. And if you look at what is coming up in Lau, a sugar company already is in Numan. The sister company of that sugar company is coming up in Lau. And the water resources development will be generating a dry port in Lau. That means all the valley from Lau to Gasol will go into dry season irrigation, driving the water from River Benue. Ladies and gentlemen, fellow Nigerians, the Northeast is no longer an infested insurgent area. No.
Okay.
The Dar in Kowa, the Lau, the Numan, all these are developmental things that people overlook and only continue to worry themselves with what small miscreants are doing in the Northeast. The agriculture in the Northeast has come to stay.
All right.
And we thank this regime.
Okay, we'll return to that and see just how the activities been generated by the water resources in the Northeast, particularly as you mentioned that, will help to, as you say, turn this country around. But let's tie that up with the issue of job creation and tourism as well, which is all part of the general projects that are going on. And we come to the MD of the Cross River, River Basin Development Authority for that.
Thank you very much. Like the Honorable Minister has said, dams store water. And there is what is called hydrotourism, which is not fully developed now. But if you have a good dam, it's a storage potential. We have a small one in Obudu. And you'll be amazed that those who use these dams are young people. During the vacations, Easter, Salah, you see the whole place filled with tourists. And they come in there, sometimes without our permission, sometimes without any guard. And because they are young people, we don't charge anything, but the potential is very much there. The river basins are actually what I will call the grassroots agents of the Federal Ministry of Water Resources, because we deal with the people and we go to all the rural areas. Like the minister has said, thousands of borehole projects. If charity begins at home and I tell you about what has happened in my river basin, within the past 3 years, we have been able to get into 300 communities with solar boreholes. We have rehabilitated 186 boreholes. And in areas where boreholes cannot be feasible, we have done about 18 surface water schemes from pumping. And we are also updating irrigation systems. we have our center pivot for supplementary irrigation, which is working now. In fact, I remember when we had last year dry season cropping, the clan head, Paramount Ruler, and former Okuibom of Akwa Ibom, he gave us an ultimatum. He said, you people have been here for 30 years. I can't see anything. If within 1 year I see nothing, I get you out. I'm glad to say, as we are talking, the center pivot is working there for about 60 hectares on a pilot scale. The same thing in Obudu. Obudu Dam had started even before the civil war in Nigeria, and nothing happened. The state government, because the dam was rehabilitated under this administration, had been able to take a loan from the World Bank, and there will be water for Obudu and Obanleku local government before the end of the current state government in Cross River. And this has been replicated all over the place. And also employment, farming families, because it's not an individual that has a farm. If you get a farmer, you get the wife and maybe four or five children. And we have hectares. For each hectare, we have at least in our area, because there is no land, you may not have more than half an hectare. So if you have 500 hectares, we are talking of at least about 2,000 farming families. Now look at a place like Chad, a place like Sokoto Rima, where they have hundreds of thousands of hectares. Multiply that by the number of families that are supposed to work on 1 hectare. You will see that plenty of jobs have been created. When people talk about the river basin, these river basins don't make money for government. The truth is that if you read the act setting up the river basin, it says develop the land and hand over to the farmers. So farmers are making the money, like my guy here. They are the ones making the money. We are facilitating. But if the law is changed and money is to be made for government, government will make reasonable money. But that is being done now with elements of PPP.
Yes, but which would be the better priority now for the administration? Empowering the farmers and indirectly the populace, or the administration, the government, making money of it?
Both.
All right. Well, the minister says here, you could give us an insight into that.
It's a two-way thing. The people need to be empowered, and so through the river basins, the land is developed and given to the people. Government builds the irrigation infrastructure. But you would realize that the cost of governance, it's increasing by the day. The cost of maintaining these facilities is also increasing by the day. So it's only reasonable that if agriculture is being developed into a business and the farmers and Nigerians are benefiting from it, they can also pay some minimal charges that would enable government to maintain these facilities and also improve on them as we go on. Our population is increasing, it's not reducing. We have had challenges of unemployment, but you know that this government has conscientiously made efforts to create jobs by various means. We have the youth in agriculture, we have the UWIN, we also have the women and girls in Nigeria. These are different programs and projects that are being embarked upon by government in order to create jobs. But the larger portion of job creation is within the agricultural sector. And like the MD said, many families are benefiting from these processes. When we made an assessment of the irrigation season in Jibia irrigation project, for instance, in 2012-2013, we discovered that from an investment of about 50 million naira, which was jointly done by the river basin, Sokoto Rima River Basin, and the Katsina State government, that from the crops produced within that season, the farmers were able to make about 670 million naira, which means that an investment of 50 million brought in 620 million. And you can imagine if the farmers are able to crop twice or three times in a year how much they would get. And our counterparts in the Ministry of Agriculture are also working on how to develop the value chain in our agricultural production. So with additional value to what the farmers are doing, you know that the income levels would improve. The food availability for Nigerians would also increase. And definitely, there would be a spiral effect on different sectors of the economy. So it's good that as we progress, our farmers should begin to think of how to also add value to the process by paying the rates for water, by paying the appropriate rates for the equipment and facilities that they would need to use that would be made available on lease basis to them.
All right, there are two, oh, perhaps three issues here that I'd like us to talk about. And two of them are seasonal issues, while one of them is all year round. Now, the seasonal issues are, I know that in the past, there used to be concern about a seasonal challenge dealing with drought. Of course, that coming through desertification and all that. And then, of course, we have the one that's all year round, the access to potable water. You have talked about one side of that, that these dams that have been created would also enhance access to potable water. But let's look at how the projects you have put in place have mitigated drought, especially in the Northeast.
The Northeast?
Yes, I'm sorry, in the North generally.
Okay. Well, we have several dams in the North, and billions of cubic meters of water have been stored in there. And of course, for the populations that are nearer those dams, they're using the water either for potable water supply, for irrigation, or for their animal husbandry. That, of course, it's helping to reduce the migration that usually takes place from the north to other parts of the country. And I'm sure you are aware of government efforts also to ensure the development of the Great Green Wall, which our counterparts in the Ministry of Environment are handling. Already the project has taken off, and it's thousands of hectares of thousands of kilometers of land that is being planted with appropriate trees, and communities within those areas are also benefiting from the project. It's creating jobs for the people. It's also helping them to settle, and water facilities are being provided in order to ensure that these trees grow up properly. So that is helping to check, on the one hand, the certification, on the other hand, drought and also migration of people from these areas. And so many other things also are being done. The state governments in some of these states are also making the best use of the water from the dams to ensure that they put up appropriate treatment plants and reticulation facilities to facilitate the delivery of this water to various homes within the states.
All right, Alhaji Hassan.
Well, one of our major problems in the water sector has been the issue with operation and maintenance. And if you look at these dams, some of them are more than 30 years old. Maintenance has been a problem there. The irrigation canals have been built. They were good. They were operating in the 70s, coming to the 80s. That now has been silted. Some of the dams have reduced. We know the effect of climate change is coming. This Great Green Wall is coming, which will support, which will at least mitigate the issue of desertification. But one very big issue that we need to look into is how do we maintain these facilities? As I said earlier, we are putting an investment of $450 million, and we don't expect to come in the next 5 or 10 years, come back and say, we'll do the same thing in these areas. We expect that at least we move away from these areas to other parts of the country. So we have to see how we can put in a very good system of maintenance. One, either like one of the Cross River MD has said, is try to see how we can look into involvement of the private sector by what the minister has said, charging small amount of fees to these people who are using these facilities so that the private sector could use and maintain this system. And we take it to be something that will be sustainable over several years to come. That is one aspect. The second one is with the water supply also. We know that the policies are in place, the law, the rules, who is to do what and who is to maintain what, and we know what the efforts the Ministry of Water Resources has done, more especially on the rural water supply aspect, where the local communities are being trained, the local communities are being put in a way where they should be able to maintain and operate these systems themselves. As population is increasing, demand is increasing also. So if demand is increasing, we have to find ways of matching the demand. So we cannot just sit on one water source system or one system that we have. We have to make that expansion. But if we are not maintaining the already existing facility, then it becomes a very big problem for us to do the expansion and all this.
Okay, we'll keep the issue of maintenance in mind, but I still like to return to the Northeast, and for a particular reason, the big farm. The impression has been created here, and this for Yerima Muri, the impression has been created that the Northeast is a dead end these days. Nothing is happening there, nothing has been put in place, it has no potential, it is just a war zone. Now, interestingly, you have talked about the great potentials that, you know, we have in the Northeast, especially with these projects. I'd like you to dwell a little bit more on that.
I have started this as a sprinkler so that I will expatiate as you requested. The Northeast sub-region is where agriculture is really taking place using the available water and water resources within the area. If you look at the starting from Gombe, where you have the Dainkowa Dam, a big irrigation system is going on there, despite the fact that we have one harassment or the other. If you go to Maiduguri or Borno, today, if you listen to international media, you heard that military or Niger military were checking vehicles carrying fish from Doso coming to Maiduguri. So it's not a matter of only Boko Haram that is happening in the Northeast sub-region, not even Borno. If you come down to Adamawa, you have two big dams over there, and they are dams that have the best of fish we have in Nigeria, called Asa. You can see millions of them in the markets, dried or fresh. Go down to Taraba, you see where irrigation is planned. You see the river valley of Benue, where you have fish locations like Tella, like Gasol. All these places, you have trailers carrying fish to Onitsha every Wednesday. Then stroll down to Mambila. You have the Gumti Game Reserve. That's why you have the best animals and fauna. All these were provided and managed by the Ebele Jonathan government. And they are happening in Northeast. You go and see the conditional climate given to Northeast by God, free of charge. Why you have temperature of between 7 degrees to 20 degrees throughout there. So for those who think Northeast is a war-infested area, wait and see when the Mambila Hydro has started injecting 3,500 megawatts. And the tourism that can develop from all different type of animals that are available in Gumti Game Reserve. All this is not enough. Go to other part of Adamawa and see where fish is being brought out from River Benue. And see the work going on for building dry port in Adamawa, in Yola, Numan, and Lau. They are all under feasibility studies. Before long, this regime will do it. So we are asking every Nigerian to vote this government. Let's have them come back and do the right thing. Northeast is a basket of food for Nigeria. The insurgents will go, will come back to our homes and take care of Nigeria.
Right. Minister, you're going to chip in there on the issue of the potential of the region, right?
Let me add that the Northeast is not a dead end. The insurgency might be constituting a temporary setback, but I'm sure the region would bounce back again. I want to say that we have a very big irrigation project in the South Chad, which is about 67,000 hectares. And as at 2012, we had expanded the area of cultivation from 500 hectares when we met it to about 5,000 hectares cultivating wheat. And we had a good harvest in 2012, but we were interrupted with the insurgency, but we are happy to see that the area in New Mati is being cleared of the insurgents. We have the Kiri Dam in Adamawa State, which supplies water to the sugarcane plantation that is being used by the Savannah Sugar Company. We just completed the rehabilitation of the Kiri Dam. We also have, our honorable elder here said, the Kashimbila Dam, which it's at the final stages of completion. It's going to generate 40 megawatts of electricity. Already arrangement is being made to impound the dam because the construction work has been completed. The contract for the transmission line has also been awarded, and this would help to boost the power availability within the region there for about four states, Adamawa, Taraba, Benue, and parts of Plateau State. And all of these areas are agricultural rich areas. Like he has said, a lot of fish is being produced there, a lot of grains, of course, and also animals, especially cattle. You have a lot of it there. And the tourism potential is enormous. We have visited the Kashimbila Dam along with my colleague in tourism, and already a blueprint is being developed to see how that place will be turned into a tourist haven. Our colleagues in the Ministry of Industry, Trade and Investment are also interested in developing an industrial park within that region. And this would, of course, create lots and lots of jobs for Nigerians. What we need from Nigerians is cooperation and support. And I believe that with the right leadership being provided by Mr. President, that definitely we would reap huge benefits from these investments.
All right, let's go back to the chairman of the Forum of MDs of River Basins. A key issue was raised about maintenance here, and these projects that huge resources have gone into, how do we keep them running, up and running? And so the World Bank doesn't have to come back and put in more money there.
Thank you very much. maintenance issues are national issues. They cut across everywhere. But I want us to approach it from the human angle. First and foremost, all of us in Nigeria must have an ownership mentality. I'm sorry to say, most of us have what I call rent mentality, tenant mentality. This is not my home. This is not my home. I will spoil it for the landlord. When I pack out, he will repair his house. That is negative. Some also have what I call thief mentality. Because they feel it's not their own, they take whatever they can take, vandalize, and run away. We as a people and as individuals must accept ownership mentality. When government brings a project to that community, the village, the individuals must own it up. When they own it up, a lot of these O&M matters would be settled. I know that most people who claim they don't have money to replace battery when we were putting generating sets. Battery maybe cost about 10,000 naira. But even the kids in that community, they can afford recharge card, 200 naira every day, talking nothing. But when it comes to the community providing diesel, when we were using diesel, they say they cannot afford it. And so you begin to say there's a problem somewhere because we just think government is somewhere there and it's a Father Christmas and should provide. So I believe a lot of the problems of O&M is attitudinal, and we must educate ourselves at all levels and let people take ownership. That goes again to issue of vandalism. It's not only gas pipelines. It's not only transformers. People vandalize generators, vandalize solar panels. They remove pumps from the borehole and put in their private homes. And you ask yourself, in the daytime, tens of people come in and use the facility. And they cannot get it, that facility. The thief who vandalizes is not going to come from heaven. He is going to come from somewhere and use people from within that community to know how to get at the place and how to steal it. So we must have ownership mentality, and we must now have kind of eternal vigilance on these infrastructures. Of course, again, I will appeal that we may need to begin to make some little bit of budget for this maintenance. But that shouldn't really come from government. Community who are benefiting should take it after government has done it and raise some money to get it.
They have a claim to that, right? They're stakeholders. Well, the lines are already open, and we believe that the calls are coming in. We have a caller from Ibadan. If you just go ahead and introduce yourself, and let's hear your views or your question.
Hello, Philip Soba.
Hello.
Hello, Philip.
Hello, I can hear you. Go ahead.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you. Good evening.
Hello, Philip.
We can hear you. Go ahead.
Siri, enough story. So, how are we? What is the way out for Nigeria? What is the way out? The, already now, Nigeria is at the edge of collapse. What is the way out? Enough stories.
Okay.
We have so many stories since 1999 up to today. Many of our youth are lost outside the country, even within the country. Riding Okada, there without anybody care for them. Can we just continue like this? In the country where we have a big church, a leader, a PhD, all people. But today, what are we exactly today now?
All right.
What is the way out, Siri?
Okay, fine.
We don't need to do somebody say we are going to eat fish, we are going to eat meat. We are not talking about fish or meat today now. What is the way out for the youth?
Okay.
Enough story, Siri.
All right.
Enough, we need change. We need change. Enough.
Okay, thank you very much. You've asked two very important questions, and you made an allusion to something which I'm sure the panelists here would talk about. First, I could put the question to any one of the panel here. Is Nigeria on the edge of collapse?
No. Not at all. Maybe the speaker is at the edge of collapse, but Nigeria will not collapse.
Okay.
We may be going through challenges, but we'll get out of it.
All right.
I think we need a positive attitude.
Okay.
We have only Nigeria
and we work at it and we enjoy it. But if it's at the age of collapse, I ask the caller, where would you go to and what is your own solution? You talk about change. Change from what to what?
Okay, fine. So that's settled. Yes.
Let me come in. What this person was asking for was a simple question. The most important single question in Nigeria today is we have developed massive infrastructure. We have a vision from those who wanted this infrastructure to be developed and utilized for every Nigerian.
Right.
Let's apply what is realistic. All these dams, let's find people who can utilize them effectively, commercially.
That's right.
Let's privatize them.
Okay.
Because they can generate money in terms of fish, in terms of power, in terms of tourism. Let's get the markets to handle them. Because always bringing power the Christmas, and that's why since this government started, it has started privatizing the power. That is the distribution. Now if we privatize the dams, we privatize the generation. So by the time we privatize generation and distribution, we are at a certain point of having an answer.
Okay, fine. We'll save the other issue because we have a caller waiting on the line, but we'll still come back to the one other important thing which you talked about, job creation, and that's part of what we are discussing here today, see how water resources can generate jobs. But we have a caller from Jos. If you're still with us, just go ahead and introduce yourself and let's hear your question or comment. Hello. 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 Do we still have the caller from Jos? Okay, I think not. We'll go ahead and expect that he'll call back. Yes, job creation.
Well, with job creation is very important. The youth population is growing very high, and with this irrigation activities that is upcoming will provide a lot of opportunities for the youth, more especially in the rural areas. We've seen example with the Kanu Hadeja Jamare scheme, where you find a large number of youth are occupied, very busy doing a lot of work, mostly producing vegetables. And if we are able to irrigate 30 to 40% of the irrigatable land in Nigeria, I think we will have a lot of employment opportunities for our people, for our youth. We put in all the necessary policies. The institutional framework as it now has been developed, so Nigeria will not collapse, that sector will not collapse. So we, with all these things in place, all what we need to do is to see how we can implement it, how we can make it to work and to bring these people, this effect of rural-urban migration, to see how we can curtail it. And once it is put in place, and I'm very sure that we will have a huge number of people going back to agriculture.
All right. Yes.
Yes. Thank you very much. On the issue of job creation, I want to still go back to what we mentioned about attitude. There is a lot of job, but the average person does not want to work. Job is there. In fact, you'll be amazed that most of the jobs available in Nigeria today for young people have been taken by ECOWAS citizens, non-Nigerians, who are ready to soil their hand and sweat it out. There is no way you will talk of job without wanting to put in some effort. I remember some youths visited us, and we should assist them. And we told them, please, we have a pilot scheme. We'll give your youth cooperative about 3 hectares. We have tractors. We'll assist you. Come and take it. They never came back. All they keep doing is keep sending texts. We are going to do launches also today. Please come and support us. When we talk of job creation, are we really ready to work? That's the question we must ask ourselves. What is the way forward? The way forward is productivity.
Right.
Productivity does not come by lazing around. It comes by bending your back. All the things which we import, some young people in Malaysia, in India, in Thailand, are sweating it out. I want to appeal to Nigerians. We have the potentials. I believe this is the best place on planet Earth, but we must work it out. When God gave Garden of Eden to Abraham, he asked him to work it. This is our Garden of Eden. We must work it out. And when we work it out, everything will fall in place. And that is why the government is providing the infrastructure. On the water sector, there is a committee of government which all river basins are meeting, thinking of how to privatize and commercialize the river basin. It was done before. It was not successful. Now we're having a rethink and bringing new models and seeing what to do. But no matter what model will be, the most important input into productivity is the man. And when the man is there, things will go right. When the man is wrong, give him a very brand new plane, he will crash it. Mm-hmm. So I plead with all of us, change our attitude, let's bend down and get Nigeria to work, and we shall reap.
All right. Mm-hmm. Another caller on the line. Yes. Hello.
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 Hello. Yes, could you just turn down the volume of your TV so we can avoid this hurlback or the echo? Right. Well, I think that is gone. But
let me chip in on the employment.
Right.
In agri sector, relating with water resources, the federal government has started something that people have not paid attention yet. That is provision of 50 billion naira for purchase of equipments that can go into horticulture and processing vegetable and other perishable items for export. Today, in the agri business, we have a site in Epe where an individual is producing tomato and pepper. The same thing with Dangote Company in Kano, producing tomato and other perishable goods. All these are organized in such a way that they bring in modern seeds, they bring in quality control, they bring in everything needed. And you can imagine how many people are going in for employment in that place. So this thing is going on in Nigeria. And with the remodeling of the airports, we have more than 3 airports that are today ready for flying out fresh vegetable and perishable material to European countries. And we are working out a standardization in such a way that these goods, before they leave Nigeria, they have a buyer over there. Okay. And letter of credits are open. So our dollar will be coming from agriculture, not oil.
All right, we have a Soyaolu on the line. Soyaolu, could you just tell us where you're calling from and go right ahead? And do turn down the volume of your TV set. Soyaolu, go ahead, you're on. Hello.
Good evening.
Yes, good evening.
My question is this.
Yes.
Hello.
Go ahead, we can hear you.
Good evening, Sanyolu from Ibadan.
Yes, go ahead. Your question?
My question is, what has our minister?
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
What has she done about the irrigation in Southwest?
Okay. Irrigation in Southwest. Okay, fine, that's it. Yes, certainly. The minister
got irrigation in Southwest because the people, the farmers in the garden are suffering.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Soyaolu. In the Southwest, we have two river basins.
The main one is the Ogun-Oshun River Basin, and I'm aware that they have several irrigation projects in within the different catchment areas. The second river basin is the Benin-Owena, part of Ondo State. It benefits from the Benin-Owena River Basin. They also have irrigation schemes. But I want to emphasize the fact that the irrigation schemes in the Southwest are not as large as the ones in the Northeast, because the Southwest has more months of rainfall than you find in the North, in the Northwest or in the Northeast. One of the irrigation projects in the Southwest is under the Owiwi Dam, the Owiwi Irrigation Project, somewhere in Ogun State. I think it's before Abeokuta. That was constructed by the Gilmore Nigeria Limited. It's a functional irrigation scheme. And there are a number of small irrigation schemes varying from about 10 hectares to 20, 50 hectares in different parts of the Ogun-Oshun River Basin Development catchment area.
All right, and the chairman of the Forum of MDs of River Basins would like to chip in on that as well.
Yes, apart from the irrigation facilities, the Ogun-Oshun River Basin supplies the bulk of the water and being enjoyed in Lagos State and Ogun State. And there are also irrigation projects under development, Lower Ogun and Middle Ogun. And there's a lot of water supply projects. Also, the Benin-Owena not just covers Ondo, it covers Ekiti State. And there are a number of irrigation projects there. Apart from the fact that they have more water in terms of rainfall, you also know that in that area there is a lot of human population and there is less land. So the opportunities for expansive irrigation projects without much displacement and compensation is a big constraint. But there is a lot of work being done there. And irrigation is not so much of the hectareage, but intensification. So they have a lot of sprinkler irrigation systems there, which produces and gives more yield. And maybe if we have more contacts of the person, we can invite him to visit the river basin and they will take him around most of what they are doing. Even right at their headquarters, they have a dam and some productive activities going on.
Okay. Our next caller is in Lagos. Let's go over. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, go ahead.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Go ahead.
Okay, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
First of all, I want to appreciate the good work people are doing. And I want you to understand that nothing good comes easy. And if you look at the nature of the way things are going, you need to understand that there are some people that are very, very wicked and very, very, they don't appreciate. Whenever they see good things, they don't always appreciate it. So I don't see the reason why people will be hearing all these things that you people are discussing that have been going on in Nigeria, and they will be talking book and book stories. So all those things that you people are saying here, it is true that they are being put in place to show that there are enough jobs for people now. In fact, the work of this, our president, Jonathan Goodluck, is too marvelous. Because I have from these our brothers and sisters here, they know to understand that they are from this work, from this agriculture and the water and other and even electricity, created a lot of jobs in the nation. And I want you to understand that there are some people that are lazy. They don't even want to work. They don't even need to stress themselves. Some people like to be in their house so their money will be coming to them. And now, you know, this thing, because it's just like Goodluck is under PDP, and there are some other people that have fed into other parties. It doesn't come up with a job. They will feel that's where they are and waiting for the job to come up on them. And we need this thing to come and work. So once again, I would just appreciate what you people are doing. It's too great. And God will bless you people and give you people more strength to continue. In Jesus' name.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. All right. Back here in the studio, let's take an in-depth look, if you will, Minister, to the Africa Water Vision 2025. And how is Nigeria performing in that?
Thank you. The Water Africa Vision envisions that not less than 75% of the population in any African country should have access to potable drinking water. It also envisions that Africans should be able to have a shared vision to work together, especially because we have water courses that traverse more than one country, and it's best when we work together, then we'll be able to develop the water resources in a way and manner that no one would be shortchanged. Because when that is not existent, chances are that some people or one country might overexploit the resources of the river. For instance, the river Niger, if those who are upstream decide to construct very big dams in their various countries, a country like Nigeria, for instance, would suffer greatly. The negative impact on Nigeria would be much. So we have been working in close collaboration with other African countries, and we belong to the various institutions that have been established to promote this brotherliness, like the Niger Basin Authority, like the Lake Chad Basin Commission, the Nigeria-Niger Joint Commission, the Nigeria-Cameroon Joint Commission. We are active members of these commissions. And in terms of our performance in country, we have been working along with other stakeholders to ensure that Nigerians have access to potable water. And from when this government came in, we had a coverage of about 58% to the presently we have a coverage of about 67%. Currently, with assistance of the World Bank, we are undertaking a national survey of all the water facilities in Nigeria. At the end of it, we'll be able to determine the exact level of coverage. But we have also strengthened partnership, especially with the states and the local governments, because often people want to pick on the Ministry of Water Resources at the federal level to say, oh, we don't have access to water, you're not doing much. But we have tried as much as possible to make Nigerians understand that whatever the federal government does in terms of provision of potable water, it's only an intervention. The responsibility for provision of potable water lies with the states and the local governments. But we know that the states have very different capacities and also different understanding and perception of what should be done as regards provision of water. Some state governments are working very hard. Some are still maybe foot dragging, thinking the federal government would take full responsibility. But we have, in the past 3 years, strengthened our collaboration to make the states understand that it's their responsibility, but we're willing to work with them based, of course, on the national water policy that provides for a partnership where the states can invest about 70% and the federal government would contribute 30%. Again, with support of the World Bank, the Africa Development Bank, and the EU, as well as the French Development Agency, we have embarked on water sector reforms with the states. First, to strengthen their capacity in terms of water resources management. We realize that most of the water utilities are weak, and also that
There are many states where state governments invest huge sums of money in developing their water resources, but they don't have commensurate returns on the investment because people are not willing to pay appropriate rates. So through the water sector reform, we are trying to ensure that the investment or the utility agencies are viable financially to be able to support and sustain the provision of water facilities at the state level. We're also ensuring that local governments also take up the responsibility of providing water in the rural areas. And that is why we have also gone ahead to embark on the rehabilitation of a large number of boreholes in their thousands and train village level operation and maintenance mechanics to set up water and sanitation committees at the local government level or at the village level to ensure that these facilities first are owned by the people and then also efforts are made by the people to maintain them. The village level mechanics are responsible for the maintenance of about four boreholes. We've provided them with motorcycles and toolkits to be able to embark on this maintenance in the different parts of the country.
All right. Well, you're still watching NTH News 11. At this point in time, we'll take a short break. When we return, there's so many other issues about water resources and the transformation in that sector we'll be talking about right after this timeout. Stay with us. We'll be back shortly.
The struggle for independence had been a long and tough one. Our founding fathers and compatriots sacrificed their comfort and even shed their blood. We cannot at this point in history afford to spirit away their sacrifices for immediate but temporary gains of today. Let us emphasize what unites and not what divides us. Working for the unity of purpose with a stronger vision for a better tomorrow. NTA. Growing with the nation.
Together, no matter where you come from, no matter your religion, we are one. Let's live together.
Let's stop fighting each other. Let us live as one. It doesn't matter where you come from, your tribe or religion, man, woman or child. It doesn't matter who you are. Put Nigeria first.
No matter where you come from, no matter your religion, we are one. Let's live together.
How can we develop when we're always in crisis? Families have become refugees in their country. No matter our differences, show some understanding.
No matter where you come from, no matter your religion, we are one. Let's live together.
Nigeria, the only country we can train with remarkable potentials to excel. Let us believe in ourselves and change our attitude for the sake of our country and generations unborn. Let us revive our cultural values, which are our essence as a nation. Let us renew the spirit of patriotism and hope in our dear country. Do not take or give bribe. Be punctual always. No more African time. We can't expect to be global citizens and operate on African time. Join the queue. Insist that people are attended to on a first-come basis, no matter who they are or where they come from.
Nigeria, good people, great nation.
Tuesday Live, a network issue-oriented innovation talk show.
Thanks for staying with us. We begin the segment looking at one of the challenges that Nigeria faced a couple of years back, which has to do with flooding. And Today we have the minister here. I would give us an insight into what has been done so far as to avoid the situation the country faced a couple of years back.
Thank you very much. The experience of 2012, I think, took most of us by surprise. Those of us who are younger, maybe for the older people, they had seen similar things before. But since then, so much has been done in terms of educating the public on how we manage our land resources, how we construct our houses, especially in the urban areas. The challenges in most of the urban areas were as a result of our indiscriminate building plans, where people don't want to follow the rules. In most of our cities, the development control agencies have a Herculean task in terms of enforcing the rules for construction. Sometimes people build on floodplains, or they just block the drainages in the cities. So a lot of the states have taken it upon themselves to carry out public enlightenment campaigns to ensure that people comply to simple instructions. In terms of monitoring of the flood patterns, our agency, the Nigeria Hydrological Services Agency, has also had to improve on facilities available to them. Their hydro metering stations have been improved upon, because the president had to provide for special funding for them to improve on these facilities. They have also strengthened their synergy with the Nigeria Meteorological Services Agency to ensure that they share information. And since 2012, the agency, that's our own agency, the Nigeria Hydrological Services Agency, has always provided the flood outlook to Nigerians, so that we know the patterns of the rain, where we are expecting very heavy rainfall, and how people need to prepare for that. As a country also, we have had to strengthen our engagements with Cameroon, because part of the problem that we had in 2012 was also the overflow of the Labdo Dam. We have visited Cameroon. They have also visited us, and we have worked out a memorandum of understanding of how best to manage the Benue River system, which the Labdo Dam is built upon. On our own part as a country, we are in the process of constructing the Dassenhausa Dam, which would complement the Labdo Dam in Cameroon. We observed during the 2012 flood that part of the challenge we faced was the fact that there are very few dams on the Benue system compared to the River Niger system in Nigeria. So the flooding was mostly on the Benue system. So with the completion of the Kashimbila Dam, we expect that about 30% of the excess water within that system would be under control. And then by the time we're able to build up the Dassenhausa Dam, that would also reduce the excess water that we have, and it will contain the flood. Other smaller dams are coming up within the Benue system, and we believe that when they are fully in place, that would reduce the incidence of the excess flooding that we witnessed in 2012.
Well, all right, Alhaji Hassan, you, for a few years now, it's a pattern that's been noticed all over the world. Now, the issue of flooding is not peculiar to Nigeria. African countries are facing, and indeed, some years back, flooding was all over all parts of the world, and this must have provided some worry for experts like you, who have studied the pattern, and so many reasons have been adduced for this. How are we applying what we have learned?
Well, we fully understand the issue of the climate change, which is worldwide, and we know very well that these are things that you cannot control, but you can monitor and adjust yourself to the system, how it happens. A lot of work has been done. Data management is in process. We see that there's a cycle of, like say, this rainfall that happens. There's a cycle that happens maybe every 50 years or every 25 years, this type of thing happens, and we should keep an eye to it, continue the monitoring process to know that in the year maybe 2015, 2020, we expect to have more rainfall than expected. So we have to put in place some of the mitigative measures in order to control this flood. And one of the things which the Honorable Minister has said is the public enlightenment, the public awareness. People should know that after 3 or 4, 5 years, you find a valley, a gully area that nothing has happened there, rain hasn't come into that place, so you decided to go and build your house. After 10, 15 years, we have the experience of heavy rainfall, and then you are caught into that situation, and it becomes a very difficult issue to come in. The second thing is, once we determine, we know of all these things, before it comes in, we have to take measures in trying to see how we can control it. It's a natural factor. It is something that we cannot just say we have to put in a sort of a wall and stop it. But there are many ways that we can do to control it, to reduce the effect of that flood as at when it comes in. And it differs from country to country, from environment to environment, from place to place. It differs from these areas. And these measures also, when we put in place, by the time that flood comes in, you don't have it as a very massive flood that causes destruction to people's life and properties, but at least it reduces that thing. So I have to say data management is very important. People have to bear in mind that these things happen. We cannot control it, but if we manage it very well, we are going to give you control to it very well.
We have a number of emails here, and we'll just take a few of them. This one, of course, I think that the chairman of the Forum of River Basins MDs will address this. It says, the minister has mentioned the Sokoto River Basin generating 650 million naira after an investment of 50 million. And according to the managing director of the Cross River Basin, people say the river basins do not generate revenue. That if the river basins have all the facilities it takes, but funds are not available, what should be done? Should we use the capital budget to run irrigation? This is from David from Cross River.
Thank you, David. I'm happy with the example you have given. 50 million, the farmers made 650. What I said is that the bulk of the money goes to the farmers. Mm-hmm. And what government is trying to do now is how to transfer that money that goes to the farmers back into the project. And if that is done, the schemes will be sustainable. But many people don't want to pay. Even some governments don't want to pay for the water they get. So we have gotten to a stage where, in our own interest, we must take part of that profit we are getting and put back in the system so that we can continue to survive. Thank you.
All right. Now, this other one is from Timmy. He just says, I must start by saying big well done to everyone at the studio. I will like to say information is very important, and most people in the Southwest have not been well informed. And this is why they don't know much about what the government has been doing. So information is key here. Well, this is a comment which Timmy has made. But another mail here from Bakari says, please, how can these projects get to the grassroots in order to limit the unemployment problem in the country? This is what's been talked about all evening. About
the projects are grassroots based. I think he needs to locate the one that is nearest to his community.
All right. And so if we take it from there, we have one mail from Adewale Alex from Ogbomoso, Oyo State. And he says, please, I would like to know the procedure for a youth to gain support for his irrigation farming in the Southwest.
In the Southwest, which
well, I believe Ogbomoso in Oyo State.
Our river basin office is in Abeokuta, so if you can get to Abeokuta, you would get more information on how you can be supported on your irrigation project. That's the River Basin Development Authority.
Okay, you have had some experience in supporting some youths in your area.
Yes, we Ogunoshun also has an office in Ibadan.
Okay.
So if Abeokuta is too far, you can get to their website and get their address and get to Ibadan office.
Okay.
In the river basins, we have some areas which, based on application and location, the youth groups as cooperatives can come in. Mm. Assistance these days are more directed to organized groups than to individuals.
Right. Give us the benefit of this assistance, because it's easy for anyone out there to just think, okay, I have a project, I'll just walk in there and access for me. But give us the benefit of the experience of how you give out this assistance.
If they already have an organized group registered, they will approach us, because we also intermediate with maybe those who give fertilizer, those who give loans, and so on. Hmm. They have all their conditions. So if they are organized, they have maybe a certificate, and they are well-structured, maybe they have a bank account, and they have some people that are accountable for that organization, not one-man show, not a family business that, you know, then they approach us, they get all the forms, get registered, and they have a farm. If they don't have a farm, maybe they can be our farmers, but they won't get a large chunk of land because we have so many people who want the land. Okay. And then they can apply for some of the facilities, and they can come in.
We just thought we might emphasize that because there would be so many people who would say, well, now we have this, we can access some kind of assistance. But back to the phones, we have a caller from Port Harcourt. If you just go ahead and introduce yourself, and let's hear your comment or question. Hello. Hello. Port Harcourt calling. Hello? Is it still there? Emmanuel, I believe. Emmanuel, go ahead. You're on. Okay. Perhaps Emmanuel would like
hello?
To call. Hello? Okay. Hello. Yeah, there you are.
Hello.
Hello, Emmanuel. Go ahead. Yes, we're listening. We're waiting to hear from you. Oh, dear. Well, I think we'll just have to let Emmanuel call back later. Seems to be having some challenges. But again, we have an email here from Junaidu Abdulkader. And he says, would seem like a question or a comment, I'm not quite sure. And he says, why in Nigeria do people not have access to potable water? It's more or less a generalization.
Same question. I believe that the state governments are making efforts through their water boards. But like I said, we are embarking on reforms in the water sector to make the water boards more viable and more service oriented. But for them to be able to deliver
on potable water, the people, the end users, need to cooperate with them. You need to pay your water rates so that they can provide the service better. In some of the cities, we discover that the water infrastructure is aging or decaying because some of the pipes have been on the ground for 50, 60, 70 years, and they need to be replaced. And these things are capital intensive. Many of the state governments are making efforts, but if people are not willing and ready to pay for services, it will take a longer time for the people to be able to have enough potable water. But in the rural areas, like I said, provision is being made for mini rural schemes, mostly boreholes, either hand pump boreholes or motorized boreholes or solar boreholes. And we have better cooperation and understanding from rural communities through the water and sanitation committees that I talked about earlier on. The people are able to organize themselves. They pay some token for the maintenance of their facilities, and you find out that in such rural areas, their facilities last much longer than in urban areas. And our urban areas are expanding by the day, and this is putting a lot of stress also on the facilities, the water facilities in the urban areas. But I believe that with some cooperation from the end users and with also the efforts we are making in reforming the sector, that in no distant time there would be water available to everybody, but we should be ready to pay.
All right. Now back to the mails. This one is from Isha Kumanu from Eula. And it says, presently I'm undertaking a rice irrigation farm with my group members spanning almost 50 hectares in Lamurde local government area. I'm sure that...
Lamurde.
Okay. Uh-huh. I'm sure you'll be interested in that now. Come back to the rice irrigation farming. It says, as it is, we have to drill boreholes, buy water pumps, etc., without the support from government or its counterparts. How do you help people of such when they have a dam just few kilometers from them? And what is the issue with, well, I'm not sure what this really is, something like Chichi Dam in Eula. Thank you, and this is Isha Kumanu.
Chochi Dam.
Yes, it's misspelled here. All right.
You know, when you are a pioneer, there are always prices you pay. Chochi Dam is one of the dams under construction or under feasibility studies in seriousness. When it comes on stream, definitely the water will be available for irrigation and fish and other animal husbandry activities. But let me come in, because there was a time you were mentioning about what happened in 2012. In the Ministry of Agric, those of us who are farmers, when Adesina came up, the minister came up with the Agri Transformation Agenda, and we saw seriousness on what is happening, we went and met him and called him to the fact that there is an agri insurance body that is lying very low in activity. We called his attention, and immediately he approached Mr. President. He got an approval immediately to start setting a structure to make it proactive. Because when something like the flood of 2012 happens, the best mitigator is an insurance. And before then, agri insurance has no serious challenge, because people just claim there is insect infestation, there is small fire burning harvest. They have never experienced a massive flood that reduced some of us farmers on River Benue to zero harvest. On my farmland, we have 200 farmers who are supported by First Bank that time. Each one of them was given 500,000 naira, and they lost virtually everything. But they could not get any better. But today, if such type of thing will come, farmers will not cry.
Thank you.
Because Dr. Ebele Jonathan has approved for Adesina, that's the Minister of Agri, and the Agri Insurance Body to be turned into a real commercial agricultural insurance that can generate other bodies to join it and take some of the risk. So very soon, farmers will have no way of losing everything as we did in 2012.
Okay. Well, here also is one mail from Engineer James, he says, Lagos. And, well, this is what the minister had earlier talked about. But again, Engineer James says, Mrs. Ochekwe, good evening. Your ministry's activities are mostly in the northern part of the country. What major landmark projects have you embarked upon to benefit the South-South and South-East? Now he's talking about South-South and South-East.
Well, our projects are spread across the country. We have 12 river basins. In the South-South, we have the Niger Delta Basin Development Authority that is responsible for most of our activities there. We have also the Anambra Imo River Basin Development Authority. And then we have the Cross River Basin Development Authority. And we have the Benin Owena. They cover most of the South-South and the Southeast communities. And they embark on different projects ranging from small earth dams to water projects and also irrigation projects. But when we seem to concentrate on the northern part, it's because of the size of the projects in the north. And like the MD said earlier on, we have large expanse of land in the north for some of this activities, while in the south they are small holder land that is available. But one of the major projects that we have in the southeast, for instance, is the Lower Anambra irrigation project. It is receiving attention from government as regards its rehabilitation. It's a project that has about 3,800 hectares of land and also has a rice mill attached to it. But the project needs rehabilitation, and it requires not less than 16 billion naira for the rehabilitation. We are in the process of reprocuring that project so that when it's fully developed, of course, it would provide lots and lots of jobs for many farming families. I have visited the project. Even without its rehabilitation, there's a lot going on there manually by farmers in those communities. We also have the Adani irrigation project, which is also under rehabilitation. And a number of dams are under construction, like the Amuzere Dam has been completed. We have the Ivo Dam. It's a multi-purpose dam. It has the water supply component of it. It has irrigation. It also has
the development of access road to it and a power component. I mentioned in my interview earlier today about the Ogwashiku Dam, which is in Delta State. It's nearing completion because it's going to also generate about 3 megawatts of electricity. But the dam aspect of it has been completed because the water has been impounded. The reservoir has been impounded. And we have a number of dams here and there. Earlier on, the MD talked about the Obudu Dam that is being rehabilitated, which the Cross River State Government is also taking advantage of to expand the water supply to more than 4 local governments within that area. So a number of projects are being undertaken in different parts of the south and the southeast.
Yes, Andy.
Yes, thank you. Apart from the dams, like we have Ife Dam or Wena Dam, there are other peculiar ecological projects being handled by federal government. Right from our youth, I was brought up in Nevada. I used to hear of Ogunpa Flood. I think World Bank has just given some assistance to make sure that perennial problem, which has been there for up to 50 years, is being solved. That is in the southwest. Apart from that, there are so many other erosion projects which are taking place in the southeast, in the south-south, in Niger Delta proper itself. So while there may be a lot of irrigation activities in the north, there are a lot of flood control erosion projects. There is what is called NUMAP, which is being assisted by World Bank to tackle erosion problems in the southeast of Nigeria because of the population pressure. So these things are based on ecological peculiarities. Mm-hmm. And that is what river basin is all about. It's not just about river. River basin means the catchment area or the land area that contributes water that flows in the river. So we conserve the water, we conserve the land. If it's irrigation, we do it. If it's flood control, we get it done.
All right. Thank you. Now, Abbas has sent in a number of questions here. We'll just take some of them. And excuse me. This one, he says, what is happening to the National Water Policy and the Water Resources Bill? He wants the minister to answer that.
National Water Policy, well, we are working on that. Last year, we were able to get the National Water Resources Master Plan approved by the Federal Executive Council. And this is in circulation to all stakeholders so that we'll be guided on the development of water resources in the country. The National Water Bill, last year also we presented the draft to the different stakeholders. They have made their input, so we are tidying up on it so we can send it to the Ministry of Justice for final vetting. Before it would be forwarded to the National Assembly for passage into law. Of course, when they work on it, it would also be sent back to Mr. President for assent. The National Water Policy is also under review, and we also have the National Policy on Irrigation. That is also in the process of being developed. We are being assisted on that by the Food and Agricultural Organization. For the National Water Resources Bill, again, we're supported by international development partners. The EU is supporting that, and also the World Bank is assisting us, especially with the water sector reform. So we're working on a number of these bills and policies that would help guide the development of water resources in Nigeria.
Well, staying with the minister, this one is a follow-up to that, and it's still Abbas saying, you said access to safe water is 57% or thereabouts. What's happening to the national monitoring and evaluation framework?
to track the progress of water supply in the country?
Well, correction, our access is about 67%, not 57. Mm-hmm. We're making progress, not going backwards. Mm-hmm. We started at 58% in 2010, 2011, and now we are at about 67%. And I said earlier on that we are undertaking a national survey on the water facilities generally across the country. And once that is completed, we would share the information with stakeholders, and then we'll present it to the public.
Okay. And back to the River Basin Development Authorities. They are into water supply, doing constituency boreholes without supporting operation and maintenance. And you talked about that a while ago. Many of the boreholes, he says, are broken down. What's been done to address these issues?
Thank you very much. Many of the boreholes are broken down. Many of them that break down have to do with issue of operations and maintenance. Mm. Even though many people are trained to operate, some of the operators are most times not available. And so the schemes are left for anybody who comes around to operate, whether they have an idea or not. So there is lack of proper operation by the communities.
Could the operation of these boreholes be further simplified so that just about anybody could operate them?
Well, you know, if you have something that everybody handles, you can be sure that's a recipe for disaster. Mm. But actually, what we are trying to do in some communities experimenting is, some have tried to privatize in a case. They get someone from the community and lease it to him, and he runs it. So he provides all the people who are working on it. Also, we train a number of community members, youths, maybe three or four. You know, young people are very, very mobile. You train him, he's very excited. Before you hear it, after 6 months, he has gone away. Again, the operation and maintenance, like I said, has to do with people owning it up. Most of what people are complaining about are very, very simple things. For example, there was a company that told us their scheme was not working at the height of the Harmattan. You know what was the problem? The whole panels have been covered with Harmattan dust. All they needed was someone to climb and just dust the panel. The dust is gone. Solar intensity improves and water is flowing. Mm. So we are trying to, like the minister said, educate people about these things and also give them some assistance. And maybe we'll go and get some manuals for them. If these young people can read, and then train more people, because people are very mobile in the communities. These are some of the ways we can get. And also many of them, again, vandalization. Uh-huh. It's a big problem. And I don't think Nigerians are vandals. If we can apprehend these people, if the security agents can help us, because some have been apprehended, but when you get to try and prosecute them, you see one big man offering himself and putting pressure, that boy should not be disgraced, that man should be let go. But I think a time must come when we must make example of people so that people will know that there is something that is penalty that goes with this kind of misbehavior.
Alhaji Hassan, you see evidence of this quite a lot in rural communities.
Yes. In rural communities, actually what could be done, one of the best solutions there is to have very good awareness, training of the communities, identifying focal point people within the community, like community leaders and the youth group who could oversee the operations of these facilities. The next step would be, as he has said, is if the scheme is at a more advanced stage, you can bring in the private sector, a local private operator, who maybe charges a small amount of fee to those people who are using it in the community, and then he maintain and operate the system for you.
Well, you're sure you wouldn't have to worry about that local operator turning out to be a water czar?
There should be checks and balances.
Yeah, there should be checks and balances. And I'm sure the government has put in a lot of mitigative measures to try to control such type of issues that has been happening. You know, you have the ordinary hand pump is not a big problem to maintain and operate and replace on this. But when you come to the solar powered or the motorized scheme, that is where the problem is. And in that case, if you don't have a very good maintenance system put in place, just as what he is saying, then you are in a very big problem, because just putting the facility and tell them that you can now come and take water, you can now operate the system, and you go the next day when you come, the scheme is already broken down and nobody bothers to come back and look at it. And he has said, once it is broken down and somebody identifies that if it is the pump that is bad, somebody will come in and say, I'm going to replace the pump for you, let me take it. And once you take it away, it has gone, it never comes back. So the awareness, training, and community support should be provided to enable the community themselves to understand that this facility is ours. Mm-hmm. It's not meant for anybody, and we should protect it and see how we can maintain it effectively.
All right. Let me just add that many communities these days have vigilante groups. Mm-hmm. I think they need to expand the briefs for the vigilante group, or the job description for them, to include keeping vigilance on facilities, common facilities within the communities. I think that would help a great deal. While you have some local people being trained for operation and maintenance, there's also need to be vigilant. Not long ago, a community drew my attention to the fact that they had problems with their borehole, and I asked what exactly was the problem. They said certain things were stolen. And I said, but what were you doing? There's so many communities out there that are desirous of government providing these facilities for them. So if government provides for you and you cannot look after it, you don't expect that government will come and replace the stolen thing when the thief is likely to be within the community. We would rather go to the next community that does not have than to come back to you. Mm. Because coming back to you when you have neglected the facility given to you would be denying the next community having access to potable water.
Mm. All right, as we wind down, this question would go through all our panelists tonight, and this is as we wind down this program here. We'll return to the issue of agriculture, because as we have identified, this is not business, and this sector is key to agriculture. And there are about 1 million, or just above 1,500,000 families who are cultivating crops using irrigation facilities nationwide. What we're saying is, how can this number be further increased and supported? Because from what we know, they're said to be generating about 45 billion naira annual income. How can this be further increased?
So it will be.
Right, okay.
First of all, let's go by the fact that the agriculture is now a business. There is going to be a processing unit or processing zone for the products they are producing. Let it be rice, let it be maize, guinea corn, or rice, guinea corn, and groundnuts. This three particular items grow on the same type of soil, and they are located whereby there is a particular dam that serves this area. And with the processing zone coming up there, three things happen at the same time. The farmer has, all the farmers will be given the right price of their products. The byproducts that comes from the processing units of the harvested crop will be stored. The byproduct that come from after harvest will be mixed with the one that come from the processing unit. and will take care of all the animals that are available within that processing zone.
Okay. So that's one
this way automatically create a peaceful atmosphere between the farmers and the cattle rearers,
okay,
or the grazing families.
All right.
Then the third item is the families. With the settlement and availability of this product for animals and human consumption, their family will have maternity. No more moving cattle from here to there, goat from here to there. They will undergo inoculation or anything going on within the family for upkeep of their children. Then their children will go to school.
Okay, we must at this point quickly pack in just what we have to put across. In a few seconds, MD.
I want to thank Nigerians for the cooperation they have given and assure them that the river basins are being refocused, are being made more efficient and giving value for money and delivering dividends of good governance and democracy to the grassroots. And we want to assure you that you will get value for money. And we are Nigerians, major stakeholders who have no other country and must make sure Nigeria works. Thank you.
From the perspective of the World Bank.
I think we have a well-defined process in place for water resources management in Nigeria now. And I'm very sure that once it is implemented and put in place and monitored very well, in the next few years we will talk of agriculture being the major theme for Nigeria than the oil.
Minister, the last word, what do we project for the future?
Well, the future is very bright for us. We've seen the commitment of President Goodluck Jonathan-led administration in the development of the water sector, which by extension also has a great impact on the agricultural sector and of course other sectors of the economy generally. The future is bright with President Goodluck Ebele Jonathan. So I appeal to Nigerians to support his re-election bid on the 28th of March 2015. And the sky would definitely be our limit as a country in terms of water resources development and also agricultural development. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. And it is on that note we'll round off this program. I'd like to say a very big thank you to our guests here this evening. Thank you for being here with us. And just to say that to all of you who join in this program through your phone calls and your emails, we'd like to say thank you for being part of it. Next week, we'll reach you again on NTA Tuesday Live. I'm Cyril Stober. Bye for now.